graduation, that's pretty much what I did, was transcribe Charlie Parker solos, and a little bit of Sonny Rollins too, I would say, some Freddie Hubbard solos, some different things. So I was transcribing a lot, and I was memorizing all this stuff. And I would sit in my room. My parents got worried about me at a certain point because they you know, I would sit in my room and just like obsessively. You know, play bird lines in 12 keys, you know, for hours.
Oh, yeah.
And that's basically how I learned my vocabulary was just because I felt so in love with those shapes and hearing, you know, my favorite players of the day play those solos and make those harmonies and make those beautiful shapes on the horn. And there was something about it that I can't exactly describe, but there was something about falling in love with the geometry of jazz, falling in love with the shape of those lines. And you know, hearing those harmonies for the first time. I remember the first time I heard like the diminished scale, and or especially you know, you get to hear the classic Coltrane. You know, the first time I heard someone play that, I was like, what the hell is that? You know, I mean, it freaked me out. I was like, I have to know what that is. And of course, you know, Pat Zimmerle, who was my mentor, wouldn't tell me. He was like, no, you're not ready for that. What he said. So I was like, screw you, you know. But I went home and I tried to figure it out, and I couldn't figure it out, and no one would tell me. And so as a result of sitting at home for like a couple hours trying to figure out what this sound was that he had played and that I had heard, and that I was hungry to know what it was, I probably came up with 10 other lines that weren't the diminished scale at all, but that became stuff that I would play. So that's kind of the beauty of it in a way, right? I mean, it was like I had this real thirst to know what was going on, and even when I couldn't reach it, I was still figuring other things out at the same time. Like just because I had this need to figure out what was going on behind the music, you know, to find out what it was that made these people sound the way they did, you know, what was it that, you know, why would I listen to Billie Holiday and fall in love with that phrasing so hard? What was it about how she would sing a melody? And so then I would get kind of down to brass tacks and figure out, well, you know, she's doing this rhythmically with the phrases, and she's changing these notes, and she's, you know, she's being very economic with the way she sings. Or so I started to think in those terms, and also allowed myself to really be an imitator at that time. Also really allowed myself to kind of play the role of my heroes, like get into the role of, you know, what does it feel like to play a solo along with Johnny Griffin? What does it feel like to write down a solo and memorize a Sonny Rollins solo and play it along with the record and get as close as humanly possible to his phrasing and to his articulation and to his feel and to his sound? I immersed myself in all of that stuff. I mean, you know, to me it's like, you know, I remember going to see Matisse and Picasso exhibit when the first time it came around to MoMA. This was mid-90s, I went to see it. And they had this amazing retrospective of Matisse and Picasso. Everyone who had Henri Matisse and Pablo Picasso were, right? So, you know, two of the greatest painters of the 20th century. And what was really amazing about it is you could see from their earliest works where they were both doing the same kind of stuff, like doing still lifes, doing nudes, you know, doing their studies, basically, doing, like, getting their chops together. And so you would see the whole first third of the exhibition was you saw them getting it together, getting their licks together, getting like working with color, figuring out form, figuring out, you know, all the things that they needed to do so that they could gain this new expression later on. And I look at it the same way. I mean, I tell my students, like, I'm unabashedly a fan of just, you know what, go through a period of really serious imitation for a while. I mean, that's the best thing you can possibly do. For most of you, probably at this age, I look in the audience, most of you are sort of at that age, I think, that it would behoove you to do that. Because at a certain point, what's going to happen is all of that stuff will start, if you really do it adamantly, if you really do it diligently, all that stuff will start to melt and morph and become, it's like throwing ingredients into a stew. If you know, when you first make a soup, everything is kind of separate ingredients, and you have your carrots, and you have your celery, and you have your broth, and you have this. But then, over time, you know, and in jazz terms, we're talking years, all that stuff starts to gestate and become something else. And it becomes like a mixture of something that's greater than the sum of its parts, right? So for me, that's kind of how I got to where I got, was by, you know, doing some serious imitation of my heroes, and then, you know, playing tons of sessions and gigs, and all of that stuff starts to morph and become something else. Either, you know, sometimes just by osmosis, just through the weird wonders of the human brain, and sometimes on purpose, sometimes because I said, oh, I'm kind of sick of my you know, my repertoire or my lexicon of vocabulary. So I would make a point to really change it at a certain point. And every so often I do what I call a melodic house cleaning. And I'll sort of like say, you know what, I'm tired of, I always play this one thing in this situation. So I'll sit for an afternoon and I'll find 10 other ways to get through that particular tune. Or maybe it's even like 4 to 8 bars. You know, I remember the first time a teacher had me play Have You Met Miss Jones, and of course, like most students do, you know, you can kind of play the A section, and then you get to the bridge, and those two fives are foreign to you, and everyone folds, right? The first time you play Have You Met Miss Jones, the bridge is hard. And so after about 2 or 3 weeks, my teacher said, you know, man, like, you're folding every time, you know, you need to go home and write out a bridge that works for you through Have You Met Miss Jones. Oh, wow, like, I guess I could do that, you know? And so I did. I wrote out about 5 or 6 bridges that, you know, nothing special, but stuff that was logical and that worked for me at the time. And that was a great, and I always kind of refer back to that because it seems like sort of a mundane memory to bring up, but that process of just sitting and figuring something out and committing it to paper, like dealing with a musical issue, and not trying to throw in the kitchen sink and not trying to make it a masterpiece, but trying to make music that makes sense, that's germane to the issue at hand, that's germane to the harmonies that you're working with or whatever. It's pretty much what we do, you know. I mean, it's just that when we're improvising, we're not reading it off the page. We're you know, calling it from our subconscious, hopefully. But that's one of the. I always say that the two ways you can gain fluency in this art form is you can either steal it from the great players that came before us, or you can come up with your own pathways yourself, your own melodic pathways, your own harmonic pathways, and that means sitting and doing it slowly by hand, you know, or I guess on if you're adept on. I'm still not a computer guy in that sense. I still do everything on the page, but I have practice notebooks full of, you know, bridges. I remember one day I said, you know what, I'm practicing the song as you. And one of my favorite bridges of all time is on the song "As You." I love that bridge because it just goes a lot of different places, and it starts in E major, and it's like, and it, you know, it goes to A flat minor for a minute, and it's just such a cool bridge, and then it graduates up a half step to go to the last day, and it's so triumphant at that point. I mean, it's an amazing bridge. It's really, really a great bridge. And so I remember going to a Barry Harris class, and he was talking about the bridge in the song "As You," and what was amazing about the class is that he explained it so slowly. You know, he explained the bridge, and he started blowing on it and composing, almost really composing on it at such a slow tempo. He's like, okay, here it goes, you know, it starts on E major, and then it goes to the flat 2 passing diminished, and then goes to the 2 minor, and he basically went through the whole harmony of the bridge, and he started just improvising these very slow bebop lines over it so that everyone could really hear. I can do it right now. You know, here's a bridge to the song "As You." In fact, I'm going to play the A section so you can kind of hear, get into it. So, slower. Mm-hmm. through the song as you. Now, I mean, I can do that now because it's ingrained in me, but at a certain point, what I had to do is I had to write out all of those chord changes and very painstakingly figure out, you know, compose for myself a bunch of bridges. Like, and that was a great afternoon's practice. I would give myself that assignment. I still give myself that assignment. Oftentimes when I'm practicing, I'll pick a song, especially a song that has maybe a 4 or 8 bar passage that gives me trouble. You know, there are lots of songs that are tricky. Like another great example is the release or the second half of Inner Urge with all of those Joe Henderson parallel major chords, right? I mean, that's tricky. I mean, and for me, for many years, I couldn't play that song because I would just kind of half-ass it and just kind of like, yeah, kind of got it here, there, but I couldn't really do it. And finally, I said, all right, I'm sick of not knowing what this is. And so I sat down and I wrote a bunch of, you know, second halves to that tune, like as if I were improvising, but just sitting very painstakingly figuring out lines that I like, melodies that I like that would work through those chord changes. But it's very simple. You know, practicing jazz is not, there's not some like holy grail out there. It's just putting in the work and looking at the material in front of you and then just being logical with what you know. And obviously having a hopefully you have, you know, a pool of the melodic lexicon of our style. I mean, that comes from, again, transcription and study, and hopefully you have, you know, sort of a basic knowledge of how bebop works and how improvisation works with harmony and that kind of thing. And, you know, basically knowledge of the blues, you know, knowledge of I've Got Rhythm, you know, those kind of things. I mean, those are some basic issues that need to be sort of addressed first. But then at a certain point, to be able to really, you know, utilize those tools to be able to compose and have like sort of a musical notebook of ideas that you can carry around with you that you can refer to later. I know that Sonny Rollins, I've talked to Mark Salskin, a great piano player who played with Sonny Rollins for, I don't know, 25, 30 years. And he says that Sonny, in his house, he's seen them, that has like an entire shelf of practice notebooks that's like that, you know, from over the years, just notes that he's taken on his own practice. I mean, that's why Sonny Rollins is Sonny Rollins. One of the reasons why Sonny Rollins is Sonny Rollins is that he did that. He had the drive to do that. And so, you know, just encyclopedic, you know, ideas after ideas after ideas that he kept track of, you know, May 1st, 1967, you know, practiced low B for 10 minutes. I mean, whatever he was doing, you know, but he really did that. I mean, he really kept a journal of everything he was doing. I mean, to me, that's amazing. That's the best thing you could possibly do is to track your progress like that. I mean, if you do that, if you actually were to like be meticulous about or very adamant and committed every day, and you wouldn't even have to be, you don't have to practice for 8 hours a day. If you did that and you practiced for a couple hours a day, but practice smart like that, man, that's gonna go further than just sitting in the practice room just trying to find stuff, you know, for an entire 8 hour session or something like that. Like practice smart, not harder. You know what I mean? I believe in that. I think that there's something to that. Does anyone have any questions? I'm kind of talking at you right now. Yeah.
This might be inappropriate, but I actually have a year long practice schedule I just created.
Oh, that's awesome. That's great.
Can you pick at it?
Can I look at it? Well, can you actually, instead of me looking at it, can you give us an example?
Like, yeah, so I started playing 10 or 18 months ago, and I'm now obsessed with it, and I need to get control in all 12 keys, so I'm doing a key a month, and I just, first I just play for like an hour straight just in the key, and then once I can do that, I just do a blues in the key, then rhythm changes in the key, and then I take every tune I know through the key.
That's a lot.
Yeah, so I'm doing A right now.
Okay.
And then next month I do E, then B, F sharp.
Right.
I'm gonna go all the way around.
Around the cycle fifths, right? Sure.
And then for transcriptions, I often get way ahead of myself, and every solo is the best. So I get
right.
It's difficult to stay focused, so I just said, who are 12 people I actually really want to spend time with?
Uh-huh.
And then so like this month is Stanley Turrentine.
Okay.
And I picked two solos. For example, this is But Not For Me, and his Red Clay solo.
Uh-huh. On, right, with Freddie Hubbard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for January, I'm listening to them only.
Yeah.
Then February, I start Coltrane.
Uh-huh.
I'll listen to him, and I'll sing the Stanley Turrentine solos.
Wow.
And then,
well, this is very. No, I mean, I guess the point is that what you've done is very kind of super super organized. I mean, that's very organized. That's not how I've ever worked. But I mean, and I guess the point, not to cut you off.
No, you're good.
But I guess hearing that, that's if that works for you and you can groove with that, if you can groove with that style of doing it, man, go do that. That's great. Whatever works for you is great. I mean, you know, I'm not one of these people that says that everyone has to practice in the same way. I think people get to it in different ways, and if having like a real regimen like that is what helps you get to where you want to go, then that's fantastic. The one thing that I would warn you about is that there may come a time where you'll get to a day and you'll be like, and you may have a existential crisis where you're like, what am I doing with, you know, in the key of A today? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, you may come to a day where all of a sudden you don't feel like playing that.
Yeah.
Or like you might not feel like sticking with your regimen. And I would say that's okay. You know.
So is there a medium?
Yeah, I think there is. I think there's a balance to be struck. I mean, I think for me, I remember talking to Dave. Everyone knows who Dave Lehman is. And he was talking about sort of talking about this issue. I was still in school. He was really mean to me. But that's another story. He can talk to me about that afterwards. But he was not very nice. But one of the things that he said, which has stuck with me, because I think someone asked, you know, what do you practice or how do you practice? So I'm sort of like the same kind of question, you know, and saying there's so much to practice. Someone said I'm overwhelmed because I don't know where to start, basically. And his answer was, you start anywhere. that was as honest, like very genuine answer. And there's something about that I like is that basically, on any given day, you know, especially as life starts to interfere, like now when I'm playing, like I'm traveling, I've got a million other things going on, like I'm dealing with getting into hotels and calling Uber and like. You know, there's all this stuff that has to happen in order for me to get to the gig, just in order for me to make my career happen at this point. So having practice time is sort of at a premium at this point. So it's like, a lot of times I have to make a decision on what is going to be practice. I mean, right now you have the luxury of maybe, you probably have a little bit more time, you know, your career is not like so packed that you're going to be overwhelmed with other things getting in the way of you practicing, which is great. I mean, that's a great place to be in. But at a certain point, you're going to have to make a decision. You're not going to have as much time, and you're going to have to make a decision. What do I want to do today? And at that point, I think it's more about showing up every day. It's not even so much about necessarily what it is that you're getting to. It's more about the fact, just like, I'm going to show up today, and I'm going to work on something. I'm going to work on something to make myself better, you know, whatever it is. And what I would suggest is in addition to having, like, it sounds like you have a very sort of like panoramic view of like a practice schedule now, what you just described, that sort of is like a big sort of silver bullet for everything. But what I would say in addition is think about what your strengths and weaknesses are, and run towards your weaknesses, like run towards that. Like say, ask yourself, what keys am I really strong? What key scares me? Like, let me ask you that. Like, what if I ask you that? If I were to wake you up out of a deep sleep and I say, what key scares you? Like, what key would it be? What would your answer be?
Right now, D flat.
Okay, great. So that's your answer. So D flat, right?
Yeah.
So you might want to really just live in D flat for a while, you know? And that's what I do. You know, I mean for me it's like, the first one that comes to mind for me is A. Like A is a little bit of a scary key for me. E is a little bit of a scary key for me. They're kind of rock and roll keys in a way, but guitar keys. But in a way, like I actually love, after getting over the initial fear of that, I love practicing in those kind of keys or practicing things that are unfamiliar, because at first they're scary because we none of us want to feel like we don't know what we're doing, and at first we don't know what we're doing. That's where we're starting from. But then, you know, just you slowly figure one thing out. Like, oh man, I check that out. I can play four bars of blues in A, and I can get myself to the four chord. Hey, that's pretty cool. I got a line that works, you know. Let me find another one that works, you know. And then all of a sudden an hour goes by and you've got four or five lines that, you know, on A7 that you didn't have to begin the day, you know. That's a typical practice day for me, you know. I might just sit there and just play, figure out a bunch of stuff on A7, like, or play blues in A for a while, you know. So I guess the only thing I would add to what you just said to what you just told me about your practice schedule is just to think about what you need. Think about what your weak, what the areas that you need to really address, and make sure you're addressing them. You know what I mean? And that might make your practice even more effective than having this huge, you know, this huge thing. Because sometimes when you have such a huge vision for your practice schedule, it can seem like you're looking at Everest and you're just like, oh God, how am I ever gonna get there? You know, where you just gotta make it to base camp first. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You gotta traverse that first mile. You know.
Yeah, it's funny. The reason I made this was because just the idea of becoming a jazz mm-hmm. musician in general and reaching that level was so terrifying. I needed something to
sure
just dig into, I guess.
Oh, that's great. And again, like I said, I mean, if that were, like, I can tell you personally, that would never work. Would never work for me. I mean, it's just not who I am. Like, that practice schedule, it would be over within a day for me.
Yes.
I couldn't do it. But I'm not saying that it's wrong. I'm saying it might be perfect for you. I don't know. I mean, I don't know that. So if it works for you, then I totally endorse it. You know, it's about what keeps you going. You know, just as long as you're showing up every day and making a commitment to improve yourself musically every day, that's the thing. That's it. It almost doesn't even matter. I mean, it matters a little bit how much time you put in, obviously, but it's more about the regularity of it than the length of what you're doing every day. If you can get that regularity going, where you're like, you've got that momentum, like, yep, I practiced today. Yep, I learned this today, and mark it off in your book. Again, I wish I had brought an example. I have notebooks like that too, from over the years, where it's just like, you know, I transcribed this solo today. I memorized this today. I did this today. You know, and it's nice because as that adds up, as you see your sort of like your volumes add up of those things that you've done, it feels good. You know, it feels like it's like, wow, I've accomplished. You can see it's like a physical manifestation of your work. You know, and that kind of keeps you going. You know, I wish I could apply that to exercise too. That's my next goal. is to apply it to my own body. That's the next thing. Maybe that's a whole other issue. Any other questions? Yeah.
Do you ever go back and look at those books, or they?
Oh yeah, I do. Well, yes and no. I mean, I oftentimes what will happen is if I'm writing a tune, for instance, and I get stuck, I oftentimes will open up one of those old books, and there'll be oftentimes there'll be a two-bar passage, like that, just an idea that I wrote down and then abandoned at some point. Like, oh, I wonder if that would work, or maybe some version of thereof will work. You know what I mean? So yeah. I do go back sometimes to revisit, just for fun. Sometimes it's just for fun for my students. Like I'll show them, oh, here's what I was thinking in 1996, you know, and I'll just open up, hey, check that out, you know. this was something that I did on Rhythm Chamber, you know. So it could be anything, but yeah, I do revisit it once in a while, not every day, and it's more just about the habit of it than necessarily using it as a tool for future, you know, composition or whatever. Although it can be, actually, Steve Nelson, the vibes player, does that. He keeps a journal of what's more like musical motives or ideas, and they're not full songs, but they're like, oftentimes they're like four bar passages that he digs. They're like, hey, check it out, man. He'll play, you know, he'll play you like four bars of like this really hip stuff, and I'm like, man, is that a tune? Well, he's like, not yet, you know. but he does. He has these notebooks full of ideas. I remember him showing me, and I was kind of blown away by it. It's just like a book full of motives, you know, just that he came up with that just for future reference, you know. And so it's like sort of a little bit of like a toolbox for him in a way, you know, if he gets stuck, you know.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Regarding you, like when you said you were working on some A7 passage,
yeah,
or something.
Yeah.
Is that something that you like retain like the next day, or are you kind of like through with it that day and on something else the next day and just Yeah, I was just
Well, you know, that's a really, that's a great question, actually. It's like, how does it manifest, in other words? Yeah, there's a process that I go through, and I'm, this may not be right for everyone, but one thing that I do, that I'll sometimes do, again, it's a sort of a product of getting sick of one's own vocabulary, and then a lot of times, just in a fit of pique, I'll just be like, all right, I gotta figure out like a bunch of new stuff, and so what I'll do, it's almost like cooking in a way, because I'll pick either a passage or a chord or a mode, and I'll figure out a line, just one line that I really like, and just kind of come up with it over a period of time. Just, you know, I mean, it's easier if I just do it. Like let's pick A7, for instance. Let's say I want to play. Yeah, let's say I just want to play a straight up A7, like not altered, just like an A7 Mixolydian sound. So first I'll play the mode just to get it under my fingers. Okay, so just to have that sound in my head, right? Just to get the sort of mode in my head. And then I'll start to think about what's actually inside that mode. What's inside that mode shape-wise. So I'll start to play around with it, you know. Right? Oh, that's kind of nice. I like that sound within that mode. That's 13.7.3. There's our root, right? So now, if I'm thinking that still playing within that modal sound, and that could be the start of a line. Well, let's see how I can develop that. But keeping that first idea and kind of intact. And then it'll start to solidify into like a specific melody, right? Starts to solidify in my head, right? I also love big intervals. I love fourths and fifths, so you'll hear me do that a lot. So there's a new line sort of on A7, on A Mixolydian, if you want to say. Then after I have that line sort of solidified under my fingers, what I'll start to do is I'll start to add rhythm to it. I'll start to mess with it rhythmically. See what I'm saying? Right? So that's fun for me. I mean, I I'll sit with a line like that for a while and just really patiently start to examine, or I can make it a waltz. There's a good song, right? So it's like, again, this is how I practice. I want to put stuff out there like that. I want to choose a sound. find out what's inside the sound, look at it from different angles. You know, I'm always asking myself questions about sounds. I'm like, well, all right, if this mode sounds like this, what are the parts of the mode inside sound like? You know, what triads are in that mode? What does it sound like if I sit at the piano and I play the chord and I just play this part of the scale? You know, and I like breaking things apart like that. It's like Legos to me. It's like I always think of, like, whenever I hear Thelonious Monk, it sounds like he's playing with Legos to me. You know, with the way he comps, it's like he breaks things apart into his own weird way, where he'll play parts of the chord. Sometimes he'll play the whole chord, but sometimes he'll just play like two, like the seventh and a color tone, just way up on the piano, and it'll be really bright, and it's just like, wow. I mean, it sounds like the sun coming out all of a sudden, you know? Just because it's so stark, it'll be like, wow, I mean, how did he come up with that? You know, just playing these, bling, you know, and all of a sudden it just like completely opens up the music in this other way. So I try and apply that idea. Like, I also like the idea of using like chordal voicings, like from guitar or from piano, and applying them to my lines on the tenor. I do that a lot as well. I'm very inspired by Monk a lot, actually, about the way he comps, and you know, the way he puts together harmony is very interesting to me.
I had a question. So I love the suggestions you had about like figuring out one bridge, or like Dave was talking about one section. But so now I was wondering, what do you suggest to students who are trying to move on and play mobile tunes? Because you know, you've got all that language that you're talking about with changes, but then you're going to play Miles mode, or you're going to play impressions, or you're going to play.
Mm-hmm.
Did you just learn total language that is? Because it sounds funny if somebody plays bebop lines while you're trying to play a. But
well, not necessarily. I mean, you know, if you're looking at that era of the music, I mean, you could say, you know, you could talk about like the first quote unquote modal records. I mean, Kind of Blue is like probably the most famous one. And you've got Cannibal Adderley playing bebop all over that stuff, and it sounds great,
right?
You know, so it's like, I mean, if you're talking about, you know, Coltrane going and figuring out substitutions on top of that harmony, that's something else. You know, that's more him looking at other harmonies and superimposing them upon the original, you know, fundamental. You know, and he's obviously he made a whole career out of doing that. And you know, we don't have enough time to really get into like the whole culture. I mean, I think people are getting that in school anyway. But basically, the question is, what would I say to people about how to practice that?
To play mobile tunes as opposed to, to play those kinds of tunes works.
Well, I don't think it's any different, really. I mean, I think again, like, it's like, if I'm playing Confirmation, which is like, you know, a chord every two beats, pretty much. You know, typical, you know, bebop chord structure kind of song. You know, there's that chord structure suggests certain melodies to me because of the voice leading and because of how the melodies fit with one another. I mean, you know. Obviously, that's the product of many years of doing that, but really, it's the same. I don't see any difference between practicing that really and practicing a modal tune. I mean, if I'm playing like a tune like Impressions, if you're playing it with like an advanced piano player or something like that, or an advanced rhythm section that understands how to manipulate the harmony, then one of the things that I will do in that case is sometimes I will change the mode by one note maybe, and then see what happens by doing that, and then wait. You know, like not, I'll really try hard not to, like I like the idea of morphing harmony slowly and not just throwing all the harmony that I know into the first four bars, then it's all over. You know what I mean? I'd rather play Impressions where maybe I change one note out of the Dorian scale instead of just all of a sudden throwing in every Coltrane modulation that I know. You know what I mean? So, you know, I might play. I'm messing with whether I'm playing a major sixth or a minor sixth over the D minor, right? So I'm toggling between the two. Now that's very bright because that's a major sixth, right? It's like whenever I forget who said it, Reggie Workman I think said, "Man, Coltrane would play that major sixth, make you see God," you know? You hear Coltrane, ah, you know? But then you can kind of mess with people's expectations by messing around with that one note, because all of a sudden if you make it a minor sixth, it changes the entire feeling of the thing. So all I'm doing is just messing with your expectation, because you have this groan, which is D, and knowing how each of the other 12 tones, or the other 11 tones, I should say, in relationship to D feel, you know, within that mode, that's a great study. And sometimes I would just say, and play different notes against that note, just to see what the emotion of each note feels like. You know, what does it feel like to play a flat 9 above the D, play an E flat on the D? Well, it's got a certain kind of sound and feel to it, you know? And then of course, the feel changes depending on how you couch it among other notes, among a voicing, you know, within a voicing. You know, I mean, if you... So now I'm still playing that mode, But what I'm really suggesting now is, like, instead of playing a D minor, I'm suggesting like a G sus or a G 7, which is also what Coltrane did. You kind of hear that the 5 instead of the 2. Well, that's the wrong way to look at it. You hear the relative dominant is what I'm trying to say to the minor. Right. I mean, that's sort of his, some of his language, his pentatonic language in that way. So again, a lot of it comes from, you know, it comes from listening to that style and gaining it, and also just having some thought about how you can manipulate those modes by even just changing one note at a time and just seeing what happens to the sound when you do that and when you improvise. And if you have a hip piano player, hip guitar player, you know, they're gonna pick up on that and be like, "Oh yeah, oh, I got you, man. I hear what you're doing," you know. And that's what makes it interesting, I think. So, yeah, you had a question here.
I thought, question, I guess comment. I thought your comment, you know, when you're playing over RB7,
mm-hmm.
And you were finding the shapes within just that sound.
Right.
That can also be applied to more static harmony, like in modal tunes.
Oh yeah.
Like just finding those intervallic things, and then just kind of, you know, moving organically from that.
Absolutely.
No, absolutely.
Listen, all of that stuff. I mean, you have to. Well, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, because this all has to be prefaced by saying. Well, yeah, you have to know where you're coming from first. I mean, you have to know. I mean, if you don't have like your modes under your fingers, if you don't have like, I should be able to wake you up in the middle of the night and say, "Play the A flat Dorian." You should be able to just do it all over your instrument, you know, whatever it is. I mean, that's number one. Because none of this stuff is going to manifest if you don't have the basic thing there to begin with that you can start to mess with. So you have to have the fundamentals are first. I mean, there's no getting around that. I mean, I spent a lot of time with teachers showing me, you know, I mean, I spent an entire summer just playing modes like. Playing diatonic sevenths in every key. Every key, right? And that's how I spent my summer, was doing it in major, in minor, and then starting in the different modes, and all of a sudden you start doing it in, like, you know, harmonic minor and melodic minor and all that stuff. It starts getting pretty weird. But it was really good for me because I really learned my modes that way. I spent, you know, an entire 3 or 4 months just doing that on every conceivable mode, basically. I've lost a little bit of that. I could probably benefit from going back and doing some of that again, because at a certain point I had them all under my fingers, and I think a lot of them have sort of slipped away. But it was really good practice. I mean, at least for having your major and minor modes, that would be the place to start with that kind of exercise. So, yeah.
The question I had was just kind of getting into that very thing. With the benefit of hindsight, are there ways that you've thought of incorporating the technical practice on the saxophone with some more musical experiences? I mean, are there ways that you can kind of kill two birds with one stone, doing the technical work and also playing real music?
Well, that is sort of how I practice. I mean, that's sort of what I've been talking about is for me now. I mean, the way I've always done it, or what's been interesting to me about doing it, is oftentimes it's usually almost 99% of the time it's related somehow to a song. You know, whether it's a part of a song or whether it's the whole song itself. You know, a lot of my practice is either about, you know, playing, you know, picking a standard set of chord changes and just working out on that for 20 or 30 minutes, you know, chorus after chorus, and then stopping at a certain point when I realize where my weak spot is, because everyone has weak spots. You know, I mean, you know, whenever I, there are still tunes to this day. You know, one of the spots I can tell you right now that what's a weak spot for me is if I'm playing All the Things You Are, and I'm coming back around to that F minor again, to the last day, like going from the bridge, which you end up in E major, and then go to the five of the F minor again. There's something about, I don't know what it is, that's a mental block for me, but something about going from that E major to the C7, back to the F minor. I don't know why. It's a block for me. It's a mental block, and so I still now could stand to probably. I mean, for a while I had a routine where I was playing All the Things You Are in 12 keys every day, and I was doing that for a while. I had a play along to do it with, and there's a Jamie Avers song. Why I'm 2, 1, 2, 3. Sorry, someone's paving. That's terrible. I'm sorry, Jamie. I love you. That's terrible. You can say that. No, it's great, but but he has a play along that I use for a long time, and it's kind of a quick, you know, it's like around this tempo, and it goes around the keys. And what I would do with my students is we would trade choruses so that I would hit half the keys the first time, and then they, you know, we trade choruses so that we do it twice so that each one of us would hit every key at least once, and that was what I would do in lessons a lot of the time. And boy, that'll show you what you need to work on real fast, you know, because that lays bare basically every bit of bebop knowledge that's lacking, you know. If you and for me, I got pretty good at it at a certain point. It's been a minute since I've done it, but I did it for like a good solid year, I would say, and every day I hit it, where I was hitting All the Things You Are in 12 keys every day, and I loved it. It was fun because I would figure out every day, I would figure out something new about those little parts of transition that are difficult for me. But that's a great tune because it goes so many places harmonically. And if you can do a tune like that in a bunch of keys and really become adept, it's great because all of that knowledge that you accumulate from that one song is so applicable to so many other songs, especially standard-wise, you know what I mean? So yes, I mean, you know, it's always a marriage of the technical and the musical in that way. I mean, I think, you know, the idea of technique, you know, there's something negative that's gotten applied to that word, because I think people think of technique and they start to think of robots and they start to think of, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But it's not necessarily that way. like I look at technique as a positive. It's not. I don't look at it as a cold concept like technique. You know, it's a kind of a cold word. Technique sounds cold. Technique. You know, but really, I look at it as the opportunity to make the unfamiliar familiar. You know, and I've always looked at it that way, and I've always been excited about it because of that. You know, whenever I conquer something, like whenever I get a new way or pathway through chord changes that were unfamiliar to me or that seemed difficult to me before I started working on it, and then I come out on the other side a couple hours later, and all of a sudden I have this thing that's under my fingers, and I own it, and it's mine, and I can play it in different tempos with good sound and good time, and I know that if I go to the next session, it's going to be there. You know what I mean? Or I get excited to try it out. You know what I mean? And sometimes I've even done that. I've gone to sessions like, I'm trying out my new line today, you know, and I'll do it. And it's a little bit, you know, it's funny because it's a little bit inorganic to do it that way at first, but sometimes I'll just do it just to feel what it feels like to play my new lexicon of lines in a real situation with other people. And even though it's not like quote unquote true improvisation, if you want to call it that, it's, for me, it's an opportunity just to see what it physically what it feels like, or just to see how does it feel to put that new line out in the world in a real-time situation with other people, and how are they going to react to it? And after about two or three or four times or five times of doing that in different situations, all of a sudden that line is just there, and it's as natural as anything else that I play. You know what I mean? And I can say that, I mean, I have my pet lines that I still play that are just always going to be there, that are always going to come out in certain situations. And they've been earned in that way a lot of the time. You know, they've been earned because I sat and figured them out and utilized them and just decided, you know what, I wanna figure out what this feels like when I play it with a real rhythm section. And that's how my vocabulary develops, that's how my style develops. You know, is by hook or by crook and by stealing and messing with stuff. It's all malleable, it's all morphable. I mean, melodies and music is clay. To me, it's just an opportunity to shape things differently, you know. So, yeah.
What kind of stuff do you do or have you done in the past for tone production, for sound production?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a really great question. Well, boy, I wish this could be another 3-hour conversation alone. Because I went through, yeah, no, it's okay. It's a really good question. I mean, it's important on any instrument, but... Well, I had this crazy teacher for a while. I don't know if anyone's familiar with John Purcell. I don't even know where he is right now. I'm not going to get too far into it because it was like a very mixed bag. The time I was studying with him, but what he did tell me that was really good was stuff like about it was like kind of like Alexander technique kind of stuff, like just about posture. It's stuff that I should actually be thinking about when I'm in front of you. But like just about, you know, for instance, like already I can tell. Like my horn probably, this is going to hit me in the chin. Look at that. I knew it, you know. So my horn is not in the optimal position to play right now. Shame on me. So this is a pivot point, right? There, that's better. It goes straight into my mouth now. Now all of a sudden I've solved like 50% of my problem by just... Make you putting the horn in the right spot on my body. Just sits there and plays long tones for hours. Again, that's not me either. But what I will do oftentimes is I'll pick a ballad and I'll start to play it in different keys very patiently. I won't play the whole thing. I like ballads with a large range. So oftentimes you'll hear me play, you know. so that that all doing that around the horn, and actually with the real key up there is to do it quietly. Takes a certain amount of control, you know. So those kind of things for tone are exercises that I did a lot, where I would just pick a line and just try and make it as beautiful as possible in whatever register I was playing in. Other than that, I mean, you know, are you a saxophone player?
Yeah.
So, you know, other than that, I did all the classic Sigurd Rascher classical, you know, overtone exercises. Mm-hmm. You know, all the overtone stuff on the different fundamental notes, and I went through all of that.
If you like, you know, you're talking really about your schedule, you mm-hmm. know, and having, you know, practice times at a premium. If you have, you know, X amount of time, small amount of time, mm-hmm. or like I need to do a certain amount of just tone maintenance mm-hmm. stuff, but mm-hmm. you know, on a tight
yeah.
budget. Uh-huh. What do you find is the most useful for you to do to keep your sound where you want it, keep your tone solid?
I usually will play voicings up and down a scale. In other words, like I like playing tenths a lot of the time. So you'll hear me like a lot, if that's the case, you'll hear me play something like. Keeping the shape constant, but playing all over the horn everywhere, you know, and trying to make it as seamless as possible as well. Right, and just you know, it doesn't have to be necessarily even that pattern, but it could be anything. But I'll pick a shape and just work it out everywhere on the horn and try and do it patiently. I mean, all these exercises I'm rushing through a little bit because we have limited. I would do it slower than I've been playing them today. But that's the idea. That's the idea.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir.
How do you work on glitches in your technique? So you loop yourself, you loop it, like play the same part over.
And yeah, I do, and a lot. That's a great question. That's a fantastic question. Yeah. In fact, with my students, a lot of times what will happen is we'll be working on a line, and sometimes it'll come down to the transition between two notes. You know what I mean? Sometimes it's just about that. It's about just, you know, we got to make this interval work back and forth, and so let's slow it down to where we can handle it, and then let's keep it there for a while. You know? So sometimes, I mean, I remember being in my practice room, you know, back in the day, and like there, you know, I mean. I mean, I'm just trying to think of a good example. Now that one I can kind of play. I'm trying to think of like. It's tough. It's tough being good at
that. Oh.
No. I'm just trying to think. It's not what I mean. But for instance, I mean, for instance, like there are intervals that are not easy. You know, I found one. So for instance, let's going between. Are you a tenor player?
I am.
Okay. So say we're going playing an octave. Like we're going between our A, and then the G sharp above that. You know, making that kind of leap. So it might just happen. You know, I might just spend like a very meditative 5 minutes just going. And making that transition as seamless as possible and trying to keep that airflow as calm and as constant as I possibly can. You know what I mean? So I'm sure you run into those situations where you're like, oh man, this line, I've almost got this line, but it's this one little thing, right? So just, you know, again, patience is your friend. The more you can be patient and get into the sort of meditative repetition of something and not get frustrated with it, but just go with that. You know, go with playing slow. I love practicing slow. I mean, it takes a minute to develop that patience where you like, oh man, I'm just playing two notes. But sometimes just playing two notes for like 5 minutes can like chill you out, man. I mean, it can really become like a meditation, you know? I mean, I love practice as a meditation anyway. I think sometimes, you know, the idea of playing a line or even just a dyad in that case as a mantra, you know what I mean? Like almost like a chant, you know, can be really, really beneficial. It can be beneficial because you're dealing with, like you were talking about killing two birds with one stone. It's the same thing because we're thinking about tone, we're thinking about fluidity, technical fluidity on the horn between two notes. We're thinking about an intonation. You know, we're thinking about all of those things are manifesting at once. Even just in those two notes, we can really think about how can I make these two notes be as musical as possible? You know, can I play them at triple piano? Can I play them at double forte? Can I play them all the times in between, all the dynamics in between, convincingly and musically? You know, can I play it convincingly an octave up from where that exercise is? So it becomes pretty infinite fast because you can take that exercise and start expanding it to other places too, and very very quickly find other sort of technical bugaboos around your horn, you know. So I think you probably knew that to begin with, but yeah, just being very patient and getting down to the nitty gritty of what it is the best thing you can do.
How did you develop a good sense of time and swing?
Well, by listening to a lot of jazz. I mean, by listening to the players that really had great time. I mean, my first favorite players were, like I said, first Bird, and then Freddie Hubbard was a big influence on me when I was first started listening and playing. And then Johnny Griffin was a huge influence on me at a certain point as well. Sonny Rollins became a huge influence. And so, I mean, I don't mean to go through the litany of people that were all influences, but it's not just that they were influences, they were mentors, you know, in absentia, you know, because I was listening to all their records and I was copying them so thoroughly. And I was always attracted to, Sonny Stitt's another one, who has just incredible, impeccable time. I was always attracted to players. Stan Getz, another one, with impeccable time. And so I was always attracted to those musicians who had sort of this very easy way with time and tempo, where you would hear, you know, you could hear any of those players, Chick Corea or Bud Powell or Oscar Peterson or there's so many different people where their time is so strong. But then if you would see videos of them, they could be reading the newspaper. It's like oh yeah, no problem. You know, there's almost no effort going on. You know what I mean? Not a lot. I mean, there's effort, but there's no physical effort. There's not really a lot of. They're not straining to make this happen. And I was always really fascinated by that. Like, I wish that. I think one of the great tragedies of the 20th century is that there's only that one live clip of Bird that exists. There's only Hawkins, man. There's nothing else. I mean, there's the stuff where he overdubbed with Coleman Hawkins. But the one live clip of Bird is we got one live video clip, one, of Charlie Parker. That's awful. I mean, I think that's a tragedy, really, to me. Because the reason I say that, to get to your point, is that in that one clip, you see him playing Hot House, and he plays some double time, and he looks like Buddha, man. He's like the Buddha statue. It's just like, oh, the only thing that are moving, his fingers are moving a little bit, and his eyes are moving around the room like this. It's incredible. I mean, and the stuff that's coming out of his horn is so intense, man. It's just like, wow. I mean that juxtaposition blew my mind the first time I saw it. Cannonball's like that too. Cannonball's unbelievable. I mean, thankfully we have more footage of Cannonball than we do of Bird. But like, you know, the thing about Cannonball, again, it's the same thing where, you know, you see this guy who's like so planted and so and so like just like feet with roots in the ground almost, just like, and just playing all this stuff coming out of his horn with the most, you know what I mean? You know what the phrase economy of means means? Economy of means? It means getting the most out of the least, basically. So he's getting such an incredible result from the minimum amount of effort, right? And so I'm coming around to what your question was, but the reason that I like the people that I'm talking about is because their time is so unassailably strong, but it's so effortless at the same time, you know? That you see a guy, you know, any of those guys. I remember transcribing Johnny Griffin and just feeling like, man, it's like water off a duck's back. It's like, whoosh, just like nothing, you know? It's just like bebop coming out of him, just like no big thing. Or Wes Montgomery's like that too. There's a great black and white concert of Wes Montgomery playing with Jimmy Lovelace, Harold Mayburn, Addison Farmer maybe on bass. I forget. you know the concert I'm talking about? Yeah. Oh, it's great. It's a black and white Wes Montgomery quartet concert, and he's playing his tunes. He's playing his tune Jingles, which is amazing tune, and you know. Playing all this stuff, like really complex bebop lines, and he's just smiling, like it's like he could be drinking his coffee. Oh, coffee! Where's my coffee? There it is. You know, he could be at the breakfast table, and he looks that relaxed. Like, he's just like, oh yeah, man, everything's cool. Meanwhile, he's just killing. I mean, burning. You know, and it's no problem for him because he's done it a million times. You can tell that it's second nature to him at this point, because I'm sure he had played that tune and those lines like so many times that it was like. Yeah, you could wake him up in the middle of the night and play that line. Oh yeah, no problem. You know, so I mean, and again, that's what it's all about. It's like, you know, it's not that much different than being a classical musician, except that we improvise. You know, I often say that there's really there's no difference between what we do and how classical musicians prepare like excerpts for auditions or for the orchestra. You know, they're memorizing too, but it's just that we have a choice when we, you know, get to actually express ourselves to pick and choose, how, you know, the stuff that we've learned in the practice room, right? So the last thing I'll say about that is that the way I worked on my time, to get back to your original point, is I studied those guys, but then I would slow that down. I mean, it was kind of stupid of me to actually play Johnny Griffin at that tempo, because first of all, I didn't really have it under my fingers just now. Second of all, it was more useful for me back in the day to pick a blues and just play as an eighth note exercise, play 20 courses of blues, just you know, and so that's just an eighth note etude maybe on the blues. I mean that's one chorus, but I would do that, like chorus after chorus after chorus, just to work on my feel, just to work on my eighth note time, to make sure that I had everything kind of like, and with the metronome too. Space, you know, and adding pitch to rhythm, you know. so but a lot of it was just you know, to get that consistency of time, I spent a lot of time with metronomes and playing along with records. Not playing along with Ebersold, but playing along with soloists, like transcribing soloists and putting myself in their shoes by copying their time, you know, just, you know, getting a chorus or two of Sonny Stitt together and play it with Sonny Stitt, you know. And if there are problems, if there are technical problems, slowing it down, figuring out where are the technical problems. Well, let's deal with that for an hour. You know, let's deal with that one bar that always trips us up, you know. And then we'll get that together, and then all of a sudden you have it after a little while. I spent an entire, wow, this time has gone by so fast. I spent an entire summer on a solo by Johnny Griffin. I spent an entire summer, I had jaw surgery when I was 18. Anyway, it's a long story, but I had jaw surgery and my jaw was wired shut for 7 weeks, so I couldn't play. And as a get well gift, the drummer in my high school big band gave me Thelonious in Action, which was Johnny Griffin with Thelonious Monk and Roy Haynes. And I met Abdul Malik live at the Five Spot. Mm-hmm. And they play Rhythmining, right? And there's a you know, monumental Johnny Griffin rhythm changes solo on Rhythmining. It's probably 20 to 25 choruses long. And it's a lot of material. But when I first heard it, it just blew me away. I was like, man, this guy's time and this guy's sound and his blues and his, I mean, so much in it that I was just like, all right, that's, you know, I can't play right now, but so I spent the entire summer, bar by bar, I had my little boombox. I went on vacation with my folks and I stayed in almost the whole time with the cassette. It's like, play, stop. Okay, what are those four notes? Okay, we get those four notes. Okay, play, stop, next four notes. You know, and that's how I transcribed the solo.
This is off your horn.
This is off my horn. Yeah. So it was painstaking. I mean, it was great for me because it did so many things. It trained my ear for transcription. Like it was great interval training. Like starting to hear, being able to hear larger and larger chunks of what he was doing. Because what would happen is I would hear a chunk of melody that I would play the first time, but then he would repeat it down the road, and I'd be like, oh, I know what that is because I have it over here. So now I can write that whole bar down with confidence because I know I already wrote it down 20 measures ago, you know. And so it was a great process to go through. And so after seven, however long it was, I mean, it was about a 7 week or 8 week recovery, 7 weeks, 3 months, something like that. It took a while for the wires to come off. And finally the wires came off and I'll get my jaw together again and playing. And then I spent the next about year, I would say, just playing that solo. Like just that was what I was practicing. I was practicing that solo. I just became obsessed with Johnny Griffin. And to the point where when I moved to New York, when people first heard me, like, oh, that's that guy that sounds just like Johnny Griffin. Like I moved to, you know, I was like the little Johnny Griffin clone when I moved to New York City, which was fine. I mean, it's, you know, the worst things to be, you know. In fact, you know, it's, you know, I was, in fact, this is really funny. I was such a clone that someone wrote about it in a book. Dig that. I was playing somewhere and I was playing rhythm changes and I think I probably quoted a lot of that solo verbatim because I was just into playing that solo at the time. I just was, you know, it's what I was doing. And some guy, there was a critic that I picked up a book in the library and I remember being on this session with Virginia Mayhew, who was a friend of mine, a really fine tenor player. And Virginia and I were playing rhythm changes at a club and this guy happened to be there. And he wrote something about, you know, Virginia Mayhew played this very imaginative solo, and then Joel Fromm played a completely derivative solo from Johnny Griffin, and it's there for all time in this book. Like, it's like there in perfect, I'm like, oh man, they, you know. So, you know, they caught me, you know. But you know, and for a while I let it upset me. I was like, but then I was like, you know, that's where I was at the time. I was a 20-year-old kid. I was, of course, I was, you know, of course I was stealing everything at that point. That's what you do when you're a young musician. You know, you steal stuff and you learn how to play it. So that's, I mean, that's where my time, that's basically where my time came from, was just the obsessive study of people with great time, and then just applying it to the horn very slowly and working it up in a patient manner so that you know, you can play from practicing from slow to fast, just like any teacher would probably tell you. Yeah.
Can you explain your thought process when you put a lick or a line in 12 keys? Because that's very painful for me.
It's very painful for you?
Yes.
Well, again, I think I don't know that it's a, well, yeah, of course, it's, everything's a thought process, but I mean, I think it's more just, the only thought process that I would say you need is just, again, it's about patience. Like, it's about realizing that you're not going to be able to do it perfectly right away. that you need to start slow, and that certain keys you're going to need to start really slow. And sometimes you're going to need to start with not the entire line that you're working on in 12 keys, but you might have to start with the first four notes, you know, and you might just have to deal with that for 10 minutes. Just those first four, maybe you might have to just deal with the first bar for 20 minutes, you know what I mean, before you move on to the second part of the line. That's what often happens with my students, is I'll work on a line with them, and they'll try and get the whole thing all at once, and I'm like, no. Let's, and oftentimes, I'll feed it to them, and it'll be an ear training exercise. I'll be like, repeat after me, and I'll play three notes. And they'll play three notes, and they might get the first two and the third one's wrong, and they want to go ahead of that. I'm like, no. First three notes only, you know. Let's get that, and we'll do the first three notes 5, 6, 10 times. And finally, you start to settle down and realize that you're not going to, you know, climb this mountain in a day. And then you become patient, right? And then you accept where you are, and then you can get to work. You know, then you can say, okay, I accept that I don't know what this line is, and it's okay that I don't know what it is, and it's okay that it's going to take some time. It's okay that it might be slow and painstaking, because sometimes practice is slow and painstaking, and sometimes practice is a drag. It's never really a drag, but you know what I'm saying. Sometimes practice is, if it all came to us easily, then what would be the point? Everyone would be a virtuoso, you know? That's the whole point of why we're here, you know, is that journey that's fun. I mean, to me, like, that's again, making the unfamiliar familiar. It's not difficult, it's just unfamiliar. Look at it that way. Like, nothing is hard. It's just unfamiliar to you, you know? It's just stuff that you haven't gone through. You haven't made friends with it yet, you know? So, you know, playing an E major on the saxophone, it's not difficult. It's just unfamiliar. You know, it's unfamiliar for most of us. But if you make yourself familiar with it, you'll be ahead of the game of most people who never have dealt with it. I mean, I know lots of cats that just don't deal with that, and that's fine. They're only going to get to a certain spot. You know, whether it be a key center or whether it be their time or whatever they're not addressing. You know, it's important to address those things. You know, and again, be honest with yourself about what needs to be addressed and what doesn't. I mean, there's nothing worse than practicing stuff that you already know. You know what I mean? It's okay to play things that you already know, but at a certain point, you got to say, okay, what is it that I really need to work on today? What are the things that I don't know that I need to address? And that's where you're really going to make your headway. You know. So, yeah, Keith.
Yeah, the very first thing that you played for.
Yeah.
First minute or so, you're playing a lot of just kind of interbolic lines that didn't sound like there was any chord changes.
Sure.
But as you moved it around, I was wondering if you're thinking of, you know, visiting different chords or whatever, and if not, then how are you sort of building that vocabulary of just playing these long phrases that are just kind of constructed by notes and intervals?
Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. I'm glad you brought it up, because that is a part of my linear repertoire,
mm-hmm.
And it's something that I guess I should give credit really to Mike Brecker for that, because I remember talking to him about that. I got to know him a little bit before he passed away. We became friends kind of right before he got sick,
yeah.
And he would talk to me about how he would practice at home, and he said he would oftentimes, I mean, his approach was a little bit more patternistic.
Mm-hmm.
Like he would talk about developing lines. He would developing, like, you know, melodic cells, taking four note cells and making it into a pattern. I mean, that was more his thing.
Yeah.
In my case, I kind of took his idea of, you know, taking melodic cells, but then kind of dishing the pattern part and then going for broke, just like through composing like long, weird aleatoric lines, you know, and I like that. I'm into that. I just like the idea of composing lines that don't necessarily have any, you know, have some specific meaning towards a given tune, but that just pleased me as a shape. You know what I mean? So, and the way I do it is, especially the way I do it with my students is I do it with a series of choices. I say, okay, well, we have generally a binary choice, it's more than binary. You have a choice of unison, or you can go up, or you can go down. That's the first choice I'm making, starting from a note,
yeah.
And then you have a choice of direction, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then after the choice of direction, you have a choice of what? You have a choice of interval. How big is your interval? And so with those two, just those two aspects alone, you have a line generator. You ask yourself, okay, I'm gonna start on concert B flat. I'm gonna go, my choice is I'm gonna go down a perfect fourth. And then my next choice is I'm gonna go up a half step. And then my next choice is I'm gonna go up another perfect fifth. And then I'm gonna go down a major third. So all of a sudden, I have a line. Well, that line actually sounds tonal to me already. But what if I subvert that by going up a whole step from there, and then up a perfect fourth, and then up a minor third, and then down a minor second. So even that sounds kind of tonal still. I start to hear tonality and everything, but that's the idea. That's my process. You know.
Yeah, I could hear that in what you're playing. My question is really, you know, since you're just doing that note to note to note interval, just building that vocabulary that you kind of have with it, is that just from doing it a lot, or is there any kind of bigger structures that you start to find and put together?
Yeah, I think, well, what's really interesting to me is how then, like, actually finding the sort of pet phrases that come out of that, where, because I'll find my favorites.
Yeah.
You know, I have my favorite shapes that end up sort of evolving out of that, out of that particular practice.
Yeah.
And then, like, any other line, whether, like, just like it, as if it were a tonal bebop line, I might just apply it in a certain situation, and just to see how it works, just to see, well, what does that line sound like if I'm playing it over all of me? You know what I mean? And just, you know, and some of it might work and some of it might not. But then there's always a part of it that's kind of, I'm like, oh, wow, that part of that chromaticism sounds really cool. And it almost becomes like glue for me. It's almost like kind of internal melodic glue, because I can come from a spot of playing more traditional vocabulary, and then have that as sort of this, you know, glaze that goes through it and throws me into another realm for a minute, and then it comes back. You know, I remember Peter Bernstein said to me, he's like, man, how do you go to those bad neighborhoods and come back? You know, you know? And I think I know what he was talking about. He was talking about me going into these sort of chromatic fantasy little lands for a minute, and then coming back to tonal harmony again. And you know, it was really Ingrid Jensen that told me about that, because she told me about being at NEC, and she was studying with who's the famous guy who passed away, who the big guru there, who wrote the
George Russell.
Thank you. She was talking to George Russell, and George Russell said one day they were talking about playing the blues, and she was talking about, you know, what can I play over the first four bars of the blues before the four chord that's going to make it more interesting. And he said, and George Russell said, why don't you try playing anything and just aim for the four chord? You know, play anything that you want, you know, and see what happens if you do that. But have it in your mind that you have this destination in mind down the road, you know. And that was always really interesting to me. I like doing that. I like finding lines that are just my own creation, knowing for a fact that I'm going to resolve it down the line, you know. So does that sort of answer the question?
That's interesting too. I guess my question is really, when you're just doing that,
yeah,
just staying there,
yeah,
but really extending the line,
yeah,
and then moving around,
uh-huh,
and getting that vocabulary when it's all just, I guess it's just combinations of little phrases and shapes that you've come up with from doing that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I would say
vocabulary of just that.
Yeah, oh yeah, for sure. You know, it's, yeah, because it's almost like, you know Scott Robinson, right?
Mm-hmm.
He has an exercise like that where he says, try and play as random as possible. First of all, it's impossible. Mm-hmm. To actually play completely random,
yeah,
is the hardest thing you can possibly do. Mm-hmm. Because as human beings, we fall into patterns right away. You know, that's it's our nature to fall into patterns. And we have patterns that are familiar to us on our instrument because we developed, because that's how we've learned. So, in a way, my goal with that exercise is to try and stay as spacey as possible, you know, in a way,
yeah,
to keep that aesthetic as an exercise. I feel like I'm still dodging around you, what you're looking for.
I guess the answer is probably just from doing it a lot and getting fluid.
Just getting fluid with that idea, but honestly, it's like any other vocabulary. It codifies real quickly.
Yeah.
Because again, you get your favorite. Even if it's aleatoric like that, in a certain sense, it's not completely aleatoric. It's not, you know, or by, I don't want to say by chance. It's not by chance, but it's by choice. But even if it's completely atonal in that way, it still is going to have its own inner logic, you know, that is going to stick somehow to your subconscious. And so even in that harmonic realm, I still have licks.
Yeah.
In other words, that end up being licks. You know. Yeah. I mean, I have a lick. I've been meaning to take my kind of weird chromatic stuff that I do and put it into a book, but do it in 12 keys. Mm-hmm. Like I have typical lines that you'll hear me play all the time, like. Like that, like stuff like that. That's just kind of chromatic stuff.
Yeah.
But I need to learn them in more than one key. because it's such a habit now. Like I have some things that are just habits that just kind of come out physically.
Yeah, so
because
it's find
like,
lots of little lines and nuggets.
Nooks and crannies, you know.
That
yeah.
You like, and then you build a vocabulary.
Exactly.
Kind of a vocabulary of that.
That's right. That's right. That's exactly right. Yeah. Just as if I were practicing bebop, the same kind of thing. I know we're kind of running. We either ran out of time, or we're kind of running.
Yeah, you probably should wrap it up.
Yeah. What time are we supposed to rehearse? Now.
I think around 5.
Oh, around 5. Right? Okay.
Does
anyone have a final? I mean, you know, no final questions.
That Johnny Griffin solo, when you ended up playing it after that summer, was it pretty much right on?
Would you
have been down?
Oh yeah. No, believe me, it was right on because I was so obsessed with it. I mean, I was like, yeah. I mean, it was down to the. Last, how does he play his vibrato on this note? Like that kind of detail, you know. I mean, I got way, 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 way into it, you know. And then, and actually, this is a good way to end because this is a nice story. The years after that, I became friends with Dennis Irwin, who passed away a bunch of years ago. The great bass player Dennis Irwin, who used to play with Johnny Griffin's band often. He played with the quartet quite a bit. And Dennis knew how much I loved Johnny Griffin because Dennis knew me from when I was a kid, and he first heard me and he was like, oh man, you're like a little Griff, you know. And so I would say this was about 2 years before Johnny passed, and he was at the Blue Note, and I had never seen him live. And so Dennis called me and said, man, I'm playing with Griff at the Blue Note. You should really come down. I'll get you a seat. I'll get you a table. Blah blah blah, right in front. And so I went down, and I went to see Griff play, and it was amazing. And there was a great moment where he was playing My Shining Hour really fast, because he always liked to play something really, you know, like around there. It's Kenny Washington on drums, and Michael Weiss playing piano, and Dennis. And he would play it in like 3 or 4 keys, and they would cycle the keys, and he would go chorus after chorus, and you know, from C to E, like basically on the diminished 7. Like they would go up a minor third every chorus, but at that tempo. And that Griff used to like to do that. But you know, Griffin was getting old at this point. He couldn't quite do it like he used to do it. And I could see he was getting. I was sitting like 5 feet in front of him. I was at the front table, and I was watching him. And it was a little disheartening because like I could see how much he wanted to shake off about 20 years and be able to do what he used to do probably in 1965 or whatever it was. And so, you know, he finished his solo and he was pissed. He was like, God damn, I could see him kind of cursing himself. And the solos went around the band. And then it came around to Trey Dates with Kenny Washington. And I was sitting right in front of him, and he looks up in front of the audience and says, God give me chops. Like, he did that. He said, God give me chops. And I kind of laughed. And I swear to God, it was like 20 years fell off of him, and all of a sudden he was burning. I mean, it was kind of incredible. Actually, I was like, wow, it worked. You know, like it just like whatever it was, he did what he had to do to focus himself, and then he traded eights, and it was just it was like watching vintage, you know. It was literally like he just became a young man for that moment, you know. So anyway, the concert ended, and afterwards, Dennis said, "Man, come on up to the dressing room and get to meet Griff." You know, so So I went up to him, and he was drinking his big double scotch. He was a short guy, he was a tiny, tiny guy. He was like 5'3" or 5'4", you know. And so I came in and I said, Mr. Griffin, I told him this whole story that I told you today about transcribing the solo, how I, couldn't play for the whole summer. He's sitting there drinking, he's listening to me. He said, "You transcribed that whole mess?" And I said, "Yeah." And so he got up from his chair and he threw his arms around me and gave me this big bear hug, It was just so nice, It was just one of those moments that you come full circle with one of your heroes. I'm so glad that I had that moment to say thank you, because he really did change my entire way of playing, even though he was, he didn't know, but just through his example. So it was really nice to be able to meet him and say thanks to, for showing me the way. So, and I'll end with that. I think that's a nice place to end.
Thanks for showing
me. Thank you.